Random House Audio presents The Last Theorem by Arthur C. Clarke and Frederik Pohl. Read for you by Mark Bramhall. The First Preamble. Arthur C. Clarke says, "The incidents at Pearl Harbor lay in the future, and the United States was still at peace when a British warship steamed into Nantucket with what was later called the most valuable cargo ever to reach American shores. It was not very impressive, a metal cylinder about an inch high, fitted with connections and cooling fins. It could easily be carried in one hand. Yet this small object had a strong claim to being responsible for winning the war in Europe and Asia, though it did take the atom bomb to finish the last of the Axis powers off. That just-invented object was the cavity magnetron. The magnetron was not, in principle, a new idea. For some time it had been known that a powerful magnetic field could keep electrons racing in tight circles, thus generating radio waves. However, this fact remained little more than a laboratory curiosity until it was realized that those radio waves could be used for a military purpose. When it had such a military use, it was called radar. When the American scientists working at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology received that first device, they subjected it to many tests. They were surprised to find that the magnetron's power output was so great that none of their laboratory instruments could measure it. A little later, powering the giant antennae that had quickly been erected along the Channel coast, that British radar did a fine job of spotting the Luftwaffe's myriad warplanes as they formed up to attack England. Indeed, radar was responsible, more than any other one thing, for allowing the Royal Air Force to win the Battle of Britain. It was soon realized that radar could be used not only to detect enemy aircraft in the sky, but to make electronic maps of the ground over which a plane was flying. That meant that even in total darkness or complete overcast, the land below could be imaged in recognizable shape on a cathode ray tube, thus helping navigation and bombing missions. And as soon as the magnetron was available at MIT, a team headed by future Nobel laureate Luis Alvarez asked the next question: can't we use radar to land aircraft safely, as well as to shoot them down? So began GCA, or Ground Controlled Approach, the landing of aircraft in bad weather using precision approach radar. The experimental Mark I GCA used two separate radars, one working at 10 centimeters to locate the plane's direction in azimuth, and the other, the world's first 3-centimeter radar, to measure height above ground. An operator seated before the two screens could then talk the aircraft down, telling the pilot when to fly right or left, or, sometimes more urgently, when to increase altitude, fast. GCA was welcomed enthusiastically by the RAF Bomber Command, which every day was losing more aircraft over Europe through bad weather than through enemy action. In 1943, the Mark I and its crew were stationed at an airfield in Saint-Yval, Cornwall. An RAF crew headed by Flight Lieutenant Lavington was dispatched to join them. Lavington was assisted by the newly commissioned pilot officer Arthur C. Clarke. Actually, Clarke should not have been in the Royal Air Force at all. As a civilian, he had been a civil servant in HM Exchequer and Audit Department, and hence had been in a reserved occupation. However, he had rightly suspected that he would soon be unreserved, so one day he sneaked away from the office and volunteered at the nearest RAF recruiting station. He was just in time. A few weeks later, the Army started looking for him, as an Army deserter who was wanted by the Medical Corps. As he was unable to bear the sight of blood, particularly his own, he obviously had a very narrow escape. By that time, Arthur Clarke was already a keen space cadet, having joined the British Interplanetary Society soon after it was formed in 1933. Now, realizing that he had at his command the world's most powerful radar, producing beams only a fraction of a degree wide, one night he aimed it at the rising moon and counted for 3 seconds to see if there would be a returning echo. Sadly, there wasn't. It was years later before anyone did actually receive radar echoes from the moon. However, although no one could have known it at the time, something else may have happened. The second preamble. Frederik Pohl says, "There are two things in my life that I think have a bearing on the subject matter of this book, so perhaps this would be a good time to set them down. The first, by the time I was in my early 30s, I had been exposed to a fair amount of mathematics, algebra, geometry, trigonometry, a little elementary calculus, either at Brooklyn Tech, where for a brief period in my youth I had the mistaken notion that I might become a chemical engineer, or, during World War II, in the U.S. Air Force Weather School at Chanute Field in Illinois, where the instructors tried to teach me something about the mathematical bases of meteorology. None of those kinds of math made a great impression on me. What changed that, radically and permanently, was an article in Scientific American in the early 1950s that spoke of a sort of mathematics I had never before heard of. It was called number theory. It had to do with describing and cataloging the properties of that basic unit of all mathematics, the number, and it tickled my imagination. I sent my secretary out to the nearest bookstore to buy me copies of all the books cited in the article, and I read them, and I was addicted. Over the next year and more, I spent all the time I could squeeze out of a busy life in scribbling interminable calculations on ream upon ream of paper. We're talking about the 1950s, remember? No computers, not even a pocket calculator. If I wanted to try factoring a number that I thought might be prime, I did it the way Fermat or Kepler, or for that matter, probably old Aristarchus himself had done it, which is to say by means of interminably repetitious and laborious handwritten arithmetic. I never did find Fermat's lost proof or solve any other of the great mathematical puzzles. I didn't even get very far with the one endeavor that I thought for a time I might actually make some headway with, namely finding a formula for generating prime numbers. What I did accomplish, and little enough it is for all that work, was to invent a couple of what you might call mathematical parlor tricks. One was a technique for counting on your fingers. Hey, anybody can count on his fingers, you say. Well, sure, but up to 1,023? The other was accomplishing an apparently impossible task. I'll give you the patter that goes with that trick. If you draw a row of coins, it doesn't matter how long a row, I will, in 10 seconds or less, write down the exact number of permutations, heads, tails, heads, heads, tails, tails, etc., that number of coins produces when flipped. And just to make it a little tougher on me, I will do it even if you cover up as many coins in the row as you like from either end, so that I won't be able to tell how many there are in the row. Impossible, right? Care to try to figure it out? I'll come back to you on this, but not right away. The second thing that I think might be relevant happened some 20 years later, when I found myself for the first time in my life spending a few weeks in the island empire of Japan. I was there as a guest of Japanese science fiction fandom, and so was Brian Aldiss, representing Britain, Yuli Kagarlitsky, representing what was then still the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, Judith Merrill, representing Canada, and Arthur C. Clarke, representing Sri Lanka and most of the rest of the inhabited parts of the Earth. Along with a contingent of Japanese writers and editors, the bunch of us had been touring Japanese cities, lecturing, being interviewed, and, on request, showing our silly sides. Arthur did a sort of Sri Lankan version of a Hawaiian hula. Brian got involved in trying to pronounce a long list of Japanese words, most of which, for our hosts, loved a good prank, turned out to be violently obscene. I won't tell you what I did. For a reward, we were all treated to a decompressing weekend on Lake Biwa, where we lounged about in our kimonos and depleted the hotel's bar. We spent most of the time catching one another up on what we'd been doing since the last time we'd been together. I thought Judy Merrill had the most interesting story to tell. She had come early to Japan and had sneaked a couple of days in Hiroshima before the rest of us had arrived. She was good at describing things, too, and she kept us interested while she told us what she had seen. Well, everyone knows about the twisted ironwork the Japanese preserved as a memorial when every other part of that building had been blown away by that first ever deployed in anger nuclear bomb, and about the melted down face on the stone Buddha. And everyone knows about the one that nobody can forget once that picture enters their minds. The shadow of a man that had been permanently etched onto the stone stairs where he had been sitting by the intolerably brilliant nuclear blast from the overhead sky. "That must have been bright," someone said. "I think Brian." Arthur said, "Bright enough that it could have been seen by a dozen nearby stars by now." "If anyone lives there to be looking," someone else said, "I think it was me." And we agreed, maybe someone might indeed be looking, or at least it was pretty to think so. As to those mathematical parlor tricks, I don't think I should explain them to you just yet, but I promise that before this book is ended, someone will. That someone will probably be a bright young man named Ranjit Subramanian, whom you are bound to meet in just a few pages. After all, this book is basically Ranjit's story. The third preamble. Atmospheric testing. In the spring of the year 1946, in a previously unspoiled South Pacific atoll named Bikini, the American Navy put together a fleet of 90-odd vessels. They were battleships, cruisers, destroyers, submarines, and assorted support craft, and they came from many sources. Some were captured German or Japanese ships, the spoils of battle from the recently ended World War II. Most were war-weary or technologically outmoded American vessels. This fleet was not meant to sail off into a giant naval battle against anyone, or indeed to go anywhere at all. Bikini Atoll was the vessel's last stop. The reason the fleet had been assembled was simply so that a couple of atomic bombs could be inflicted on it. One would come from the air, the other from under the sea. The hope was that this travail could give the admirals some idea of what their navy might suffer in some future nuclear war. Bikini Atoll, of course, wasn't the end of nuclear weapons testing. It was just the beginning. Over the next dozen years and more, the Americans exploded bomb after bomb in the atmosphere, diligently noting yield and damage done and every other number that could be extracted from a test. So did the Soviets and the Brits a little later, the French and the Chinese later still. Altogether, the first five nuclear powers, who also happened, not by chance, to be the five...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.